Now that we're done with the preliminary rating, we can turn the sheet over and start with the detailed hazard and risk slope ratings. The first three categories on the slope hazard rating apply to all landslide and rockfall slopes. The first one we'll talk about is the slope drainage. For this category, we evaluate the presence of water on the site. Water is often one of the main culprits in a landslide or rockfall failures. Here, we look at the slope as a whole. We evaluate the presence of water and also where it's dry, but we can also note staining on the rock slope, demonstrating the presence of water in the past. On this slope, I'll evaluate the presence of the dry areas and the wet areas and give it a rating of the intermittent water on the slope, or category 9. Slope drainage on landslides are also an important concern. Here on this landslide site, the ditch is well formed, seems to be controlling water well. The camber of the road is not focusing a lot of water onto the slide, and the culvert appears to be functioning very well. Here, the surface runoff is well controlled, score of 3. Other landslides can be very large with saturated conditions, obvious throughout the landslide body. These are poorly drained materials, and they would receive a score of 27. Category J, annual rainfall, is the next category to evaluate. It subdivides the rainfall for the site into 10, 30, 60, and 60 plus inches per year. As discussed earlier in the form, we've already collected this from a GIS data set. At this location, we have over 60 inches annually per year, or 81 points. Category K evaluates the slope height and axial length of the slide. As discussed earlier, we've already rated this on the beginning of the form. Here on this slope, we're over 100 feet for the rock slope and about 45 feet for the soil slope. So 9 points or 100 points for the landslide or rockfall, respectively. Category L, thaw stability, is the first of the landslide effects in the slope hazard rating. This ranges from a category of 3 for unfrozen or completely thaw stable slopes all the way up to a score of 81 for highly thaw unstable slopes. The 81 categories would be mostly in very northern climates like Alaska, or in a very high mountainous terrain in the northern states in the lower 48. Where geologic materials are mixed and you have a mix of thin ice lenses and well-drained materials, you may be in the slightly thaw unstable category, while more fine-grained and more ice materials would be in the 27 score range category. Here in the Southwest Washington, we do not have any permafrost issues that are on these roads. On these slopes, we'll rate this as thaw stable, category 3. Category M, instability-related maintenance frequency. You should discuss this with the maintenance personnel responsible for the section of road that you're working on. This is intended to capture the frequency of maintenance patching the road or putting on crack seal, and how often they do that equates to how active the slope is. So between 10, 5, 2, or every year, you should be able to categorize that into score categories. Here on this site, we have no patches that have been done, or other ones where you have, looks like something has been done about 5 years ago. Category N, movement history, is the last of our landslide-specific slope hazard rating categories. Here we evaluate the frequency and magnitude of the movement on a site. So this also, of course, goes from 3 to 81, ranging from minor movement or sporadic creep all the way up to greater than 3 inches per event, or 6 inches annually, or more than one event per year. For debris flows where you have a large quantity of material that may cover the road at any multiple times a year or every other year, you'd rate that as an 81. Talk to maintenance personnel for additional information. Category O is the first of the rockfall-specific slope hazard rating forms. When there's little to no maintenance required and only scheduled ditch cleaning required, both maintenance staff and the traveling public are typically not exposed, and the agency incurs little cost. As rockfall activity increases at the site, additional road patrols may be warranted after storm events or continuously year-round. At trail locations, these patrols could include simply staff hiking the trail on a daily or on a regular basis. When the ditch is cleaned only on a normal or scheduled ditch maintenance, say every 3 to 5 years, that score at the lowest end of the category scheme, 3 points. If it's cleaned or patrolled year-round, and patrolling could include cleaning the rocks that are falling off the road, and that's occurred regularly and year-round, that would be 81 points. At this site, it appears that the ditch does not require regular maintenance, and the scars on the road are pretty minimal, so here would appear that the rockfall-related maintenance frequency is pretty low, category of 3 or 9. On rock slopes where it's clear that rockfall activity is consistently and constantly impacting the road, where there's still rock debris on the ditch and on the road, and even on the other side of the road, this would score in the highest category, score of 81 points. The next four categories apply to the geologic characteristics of a rock slope. The geologic conditions of the rockfall section are evaluated within these four categories. Since the conditions that cause rockfall activity generally fit into two of the categories, a case 1 and case 2 rating criteria have been developed. Case 1 is for slopes where joints, bedding planes, and other discontinuities are the dominant structural features that contribute or lead to the rockfall. Case 2 is for slopes where differential erosion or oversteepening is the dominant condition that controls the rockfall. Whichever case best fits the slope should be used for the rating. If both situations are present and it is unclear which one dominates, both can be scored, but only the worst case or the highest scores is used in the rating. Categories P and Q, structural condition and rock friction, are the first two rating categories for case 1. Rockfall from case 1 slopes occurs as a result of movement along the discontinuities. P, case 1, structural condition. Movement occurs along these joints where the resistance to movement is significantly less than the intact strength of the rock itself. When the joints are oriented adversely to the slope, the potential for rockfall is greater. Adverse joints are those that singularly or in combination with other joints make planar, circular, block, wedge, or toppling failures kinematically possible. The scores are broke down into the four categories. At the lowest end, discontinuous joints with favorable orientations would rate as 3 points, while at the other end of the spectrum, continuous joints are those greater than 10 feet with adverse orientations or dipping out of the slope would rate as 81 points. At this site, we have joints that are greater than 10 feet and also dipping out of the cut face. So this slope here would rate 81 points. Category Q evaluates the friction along the joints discontinuities of the rock. Here we have three of the four categories on this one slope. With rough surfaces here, or category 3, a rating of 3. Smooth planar surfaces here for a category of 27. Or higher up in the slope, we have curved joints as undulating joints. On this slope, you rate the worst case scenario that's also common, which would be planar joints or a score of 27. When low friction materials separate the rock surfaces, these negate any micro or macro roughness on the joint surfaces. Slick and decided joints also have a lower friction angle and belong in this category. Case 2 is the second geologic character for rock slopes. Case 2 is used for slopes where differential erosion between hard and soft rock units or oversteepening is the dominant condition that leads to rockfall. Erosion features can include oversteepened slopes, unsupported rock units or overhangs, or exposed resistant rocks on a slope, which may eventually lead to a rockfall event. Category R, Case 2 structural condition, is the first of the two categories rated in this one. Rockfall is commonly caused by erosion that leads to a loss of support either locally or throughout an entire slope. The types of slopes that may be susceptible to this condition are interlayered hard and soft geologic units, talus slopes, highly variable geologic units such as conglomerates, brushes, and mudflows, and any other ones that may weather differentially, allowing resistant rocks and blocks to fail, and soil and rock slopes that weather, allowing rocks to fall as the soil matrix is eroded around it. Category R focuses on how often those types of differential erosion features are captured present on the slope, going from few differential erosion features to major differential features like overhangs. On this slope in front of us, we see only a few of the rock blocks that are present on the site, but I would rate that as an occasional differential erosion features, or 9 points. The next category, S, approximates the difference in erosional rates between the different geologic units in our slope, ranging from a small difference to an extreme difference. For instance, a sandstone and siltstone interbeds, they may erode pretty close to one another or quite a bit different. Rocks or large boulders in a glacial outwash slope that has silt and sand also has an extreme difference. On this slope in front of us, I would say this is a large difference or an extreme difference. Based on the quantity of material that maintenance has to remove from the soil slope, I'm going to rate this as an 81, an extreme difference. Now that we're done evaluating the slope hazard ratings, sum up the total landslide or rockfall hazard score as shown on the form. After completing the slope hazard rating, we move on to the remainder of the form, the risk rating. The first category in the risk rating is route width or trail width, category V. This category measures the available maneuvering width of the road or the trail and captures the ability of a user to navigate around unforeseen roadway or trail hazards. The more room there is available for an evasive maneuver, the greater the likelihood that a user will successfully avoid the hazard. On a trail, greater room for maneuvering reduces the likelihood that a user will trip or be compelled to exit the trail in order to avoid the hazard. This category score is based on direct trail or roadway measurements recorded on the front of the form. The next risk rating is the human exposure factor, category W. The human exposure factor evaluates the potential for a roadway or trail user to be involved in an unstable slope event. This risk is associated with the percentage of time a route user is present within the evaluated section and involves the slope length, the average daily traffic, and the posted speed limit or the average walking speed of a hiker. A calculation result of 100% means that on average a user will be within the defined unstable section 100% of the time. Where high ADTs or longer slope lengths exist, calculated values can be greater than 100%. Where ADTs are not present, but the economic or recreational importance has been rated, use the ADT as an example measure to use in this human exposure factor. On the beginning of the form, we recorded the site distance on the site. We compare this measured site distance to the recommended site distance for rural roads as shown in the manual. This percentage of the actual site distance to the recommended site distance gives us the score. For trails, we use our judgment on how the hiker will be able to avoid sudden hazards. For 100%, we obtain a score of 3 points, all the way from 80, 60, all the way down to 40% for a score of 81. We use our judgment of adequacy for trails. The next risk rating category is category Y, right-of-way impacts if the hazard's left unattended. Adjacent landowners may be impacted by unstable slopes, retrogressing to property boundaries and then beyond. If structures or other transportation systems are potentially impacted by the unstable slopes, then the risk to the agency increases. Maps displaying right-of-way are helpful when performing these evaluations. If there are no adjacent property owners or your agency owns the adjacent right-of-way, then you're likely to stay in the 3-point category. If other landowners are adjacent to your right-of-way and they have structures or other infrastructure, you can score that up to 81 points. Category Z is the next risk rating. This evaluates the likely impacts to environmental or cultural features if the slope is left unattended. These impacts may be to the environment or cultural resources and can include siltation of streams, culvert plugging, fish passage, habitat damages, or damage to historic features. Due to the highly variable nature of potential environmental impacts, a range of regulatory, environmental, and cultural descriptions are used in this category. The rater should select the category containing the highest environmental or cultural impact if the slope is left unattended and not mitigated. If these impacts are anticipated, a review by environmental or cultural resource professionals may be recommended. For 3 points, no known sensitive environmental issues are present or anticipated if a probable worst-case scenario occurs. At 81 points, current conditions are causing adverse environmental effects. Category AA is the next risk rating category, and we evaluate maintenance complexity with this one. Complexity of maintenance following a rockfall or landslide events is indicative of the maintenance costs and associated hazards. Maintenance could be as simple as cleaning rocks off the road during routine road patrols, or as complex as the maintenance of unstable slope remediation systems, such as rockfall attenuator fences or construction of MSC walls to remediate an embankment landslide. Scoring on these ones can range from 3 points, where it's a routine effort and performed by in-house engineering or maintenance staff, all the way up to 81 points, where it could be complex or dangerous, either in effort, location, or contracting difficulties. The event cost, category BB, is our last risk rating category. The estimated or actual cost to maintain or repair a probable worst-case scenario or a historically bad feature should be considered. The cost should be considered at a comparable private sector equipment rental and operator rates. If an extreme event requires outside assistance, planning, design, and/or construction, the cost should include both these outside costs and the agency contracting and supervisory costs. At 3 points, you're looking at a cost under $2,000, while 81 points, it's greater than $100,000, with large contract and significant contractor and engineering costs. Okay. If you've collected all your information on the paper forms, at this point you can go in there and start entering the information into your application.